Hi, friends. My name's Matthew Dowling, lead teacher for Strengthened by Grace Ministries. It's a pleasure to welcome you back to the Mind of Christ seminar. In this seminar, let me remind you, we are looking at the ways in which Jesus Christ self-identified when he came to earth. In these self-identifications from God's Word, Jesus is revealing things about himself. Last time, we looked at the way in which Jesus proclaimed he is the way and the truth and the life. But here in this third lesson from the Mind of Christ seminar, we're going to look at Jesus' self-identification as he who is the light of the world. Our key verse comes from John 8 and verse 12, where it says that when Jesus spoke again to the people, he said, "I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life." Well, as we begin this third lesson, let me start with a story. The men of a certain Indian tribe rise every morning to perform an ancient ceremony that they believe causes the sun to rise in the east. And they actually believe that if they fail to perform this ritual, they will plunge the world into utter darkness. Never have they dared to skip a day just to find out if what they believed was true. The risk in their minds would absolutely be too great. And you know, I'm sympathetic to this native outlook upon the sun. It is true that without sunlight, life on this planet would quickly cease to exist. The fact is, without the sun, no plants would grow. The temperature would rapidly drop, and in a short time, actually, all life on Earth would come to an end. But you know, just as vital as sunlight is to our physical existence, there is a light that is even more vital, but instead to our spiritual existence. It is the light that John describes here in John 1 and verse 9, when he said, "The true light that gives life to every man has come into this world." And you know who that light is, don't you? This vital, life-giving, and sustaining light is Jesus Christ himself. And for just a moment, let's consider what Jesus has to say to the people and the religious establishment of his day. We see it again here in John 8:12. It says that when Jesus spoke to the people, he said, "I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life." Let's begin with our first point as we look at this verse. That is the claim of Jesus Christ. Jesus says here in John 8:12, "I am the light of the world." You know, this claim was made not long after what is known as the Feast of Tabernacles. It's one of the great holidays in ancient Israel. And a very spectacular part of this feast was the use of a great candelabra full of all kinds of light from candles. In fact, there were four candelabras in all, and they were filled with oil by young men who had to climb ladders that were 50 cubits high. The cubit is the distance really from your elbow to the tip of your fingers. That's about the approximate length of a cubit. And these candelabras were 50 cubits high. So this is a large tower. And 50 cubits would be around 75 feet tall. So if these young men had to climb 75 feet to put oil in the candelabras must have been at least 75 feet tall. Now, you have that in your imagination. These are very large. And the light from these lamps was so brilliant that the Jewish writers of an ancient work called the Mishnah said that, quote, "There was not a courtyard in Jerusalem that did not reflect this light," end quote. So the brilliant illumination from these candelabras was a great occasion during the Feast of Tabernacles in the city of Jerusalem. But there was a moment when the feast was over, when the great candelabra would be extinguished, and the light that it had been giving out would no longer be visible. And when that happened, a great kind of darkness came over Jerusalem, which really existed in contrast with the light that had been there before. And many scholars believe it was in the darkness of this post-festival period that Jesus made this claim about being the light of the world. In fact, as Jesus did his teaching in this moment after the great candelabra was extinguished, he spoke not only of being, of course, a light to Jerusalem, but of being a light really to the entire world. This is a statement about who Jesus is that we have to take seriously. And the reason we have to take it seriously is because the imagery implied by Jesus is that the world itself is in darkness. Of course, we know that darkness is the result of sin. In fact, we even admit and confess, because the Bible does, that there is a darkness of sin throughout our entire world. And men left to themselves cannot overcome the spiritual sinful darkness in this world. But here Jesus is saying something profound. Here Jesus claims that he can bring the illumination necessary to banish the darkness in which people live. And you know, this is in concert with what was said about Jesus in the Old Testament. The Old Testament prophecies foretold that Jesus would be, as the Messiah, a light in the world. In fact, the Old Testament prophesied of a light that was to come. And in Isaiah 42, verse 6, and in Isaiah 49, verse 6, and Isaiah 51, verse 4, Isaiah tells about the servant of the Lord who would be, quote, a light to the Gentiles, end quote. Now, Jesus' claim here in John 8 is that he is that light. In fact, Jesus is not only the light for his followers, not even of just Israel, but he is the light for the entire world. That means he's the light for the poor and the rich, the black and the white, the Jew, the Gentile, the American, and the Iranian. He is the light of the world. There is no one outside the light, which is Jesus Christ. And so Jesus is saying here that he is the light of the world, and without him, the world remains in sin. That is the claim that Jesus Christ is making here in John chapter 8. But I want us to notice, secondly, in our major point, the condition of this revelation, okay? There is a condition to being in this light. And I think you may have already noticed it here in John 8, 12. Let's notice it again, shall we? Jesus says, "Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life." That's the condition, really, that Jesus unpacks for us. And as we begin to think about this, I want to invite you to think about something further. You know, people are expected to react to the light. In fact, there are two basic reactions to the light. One reaction implied in Jesus' revelation is to hide from the light. There are people who run from the light. If you've ever been sitting in a darkened room for a couple of hours and then someone turns on the lights, your first reaction is to cover your eyes. The light is too bright, too much to take. In fact, you've been in the dark so long that sometimes it's hard to adjust to the brightness. It makes me think of a character in one of my favorite books, The Hobbit by J.R.R. Tolkien. In The Hobbit, of course, there's a little creature, a funny one named Gollum, who we're told lived far beyond, below the surface of the earth, with in a cave of goblins, essentially. And we learn from The Lord of the Rings that it had not always been this way for Gollum. At one time, Gollum had lived above the surface, just like most people do. But he moved underground to escape the outside world, and the book tells us that he lived there so long that he couldn't remember how many years it had been. In fact, he couldn't remember ever having been anyplace else. He became so accustomed to the darkness that it's almost as if the darkness became his friend. This is who Gollum was. And he even grew down in the cave of these goblins in this little underground lake area to be repulsed, even by the thought of light. He hated the light. He hated goodness. He even hated laughter. Well, that's a fictional character, of course, and it's funny to think this, but you know, many of us become like this creature Gollum. In our sinfulness and in our rebellion, we can despise the light too. You know, we live in the world of sin, And we've lived there sometimes for so long that we even begin to enjoy it. And we begin doing things that we never would have considered before. That's what sin does, is it entices us to do things we shouldn't. And we start to think thoughts that at one time would have shocked us. And we find that we can even be very comfortable in this world of sin, where right is wrong and black is white. We have everything turned around, and yet we seem to like it. And there's even no longer any moral standard by which we must abide. And then when the message of Jesus, the light of the world, comes into our lives, it's almost like we cover our eyes and we say, no, turn off the light. I just can't take that. I don't want that light. And we kind of like Gollum, we want to crawl back into our comfortable world, this world of darkness and of sin. That is one reaction to the light of Jesus. That, in fact, is many people's reaction to the light of Jesus. But thank God, praise Him, that it's not the only reaction. It's a common one, but it's not the only reaction. Now, of course, the other reaction, the second possible reaction, is to run to the light, to embrace it, and to desire that light for our own. And so let's return for a moment in our imaginations to the darkened room that I mentioned just a moment ago. Pretend that we've been sitting there again for a long time, and someone flicks on the light switch and turns it on. And again, our immediate reaction is to cover our eyes. But instead of keeping our eyes covered, we find that our eyes begin to rapidly adjust to the light. And even in a short time, we find comfort in the light. It helps us to see what we're doing. It gives us warmth. It shows us how to get from here to there. And after we've grown accustomed to the light, we find that we no longer desire the darkness. When Jesus Christ, the light of the world, first comes into our lives, His life, well, it's a light that often makes us recoil. That is true. We want to rebel against it because it often exposes the life of sin that we have been living. I remember when I came to know Christ, I became very afraid because I realized that I was a sinful person, and that there were many things I had done to rebel against God. And so I recoiled against the light. But you know, dear friends, if we will run to the light instead of running away from the light, we'll find that in a very short time we become accustomed to the world of light, such that we don't anymore desire really to live in that old way. I think that's a miraculous work of the Holy Spirit in our hearts when that happens. In fact, the Bible describes this in John 3 as the birth from above. It's what we think of as the doctrine of regeneration. And that's a sovereign work of the Lord, and yet its effects are really wonderful. We begin to desire the light, and we will not go a moment without enjoying that light. That's the effect that it has on us. And you know, because the closer we draw to the light of Jesus, the more we realize our eyes are able to see, we see clearly. Jesus describes the effects of regeneration in this way. He says, "He who has ears to hear and eyes to see, let him hear and let him see." And Jesus says that to enjoy the light, we need to meet a certain condition. And this is something that He enables in us through His Holy Spirit. We must come to the light and we must follow the light. You know, in the first century of Palestine, when Jesus lived, a teacher like Jesus moved about from place to place, and His disciples, they went with Him. And so to follow Jesus for people like His immediate disciples meant literally following Him from place to place. That's what it meant in the first century. But you know, dear friends, the word is used in the sense of following Jesus as disciples. And of course, while there was often in Jesus' lifetime a literal and physical following, the term was used from the first to mean becoming an adherent of Jesus and seeking to live according to His teachings. His teachings. That's why Jesus said in John 8:12, "Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life." That's why I encourage people, particularly who are seeking after the Lord, to take up the Gospels and read the teaching of Jesus and count the cost and see if the Lord is calling you. And if so, cry out for His mercy and seek to become a follower of Jesus. Jesus' claim is to be the light of the world. And the condition here to experiencing the light is following Jesus Christ. Well, this brings us thirdly to our final point, which is the consequence of following and or rejecting Jesus. You know, dear friends, we live in an age of scientific enlightenment. I mean, we can pick up our cell phones and talk to somebody else on the other side of the world. We can turn on a computer and watch it do the work of thousands of people, what it took them time to do. We can receive a transplant if an organ fails. We can be counseled for any problem or suffering. The world seems to just kind of wait at our doorsteps and runs to us when we call. And yet we know that even though we live in the scientific age, we find ourselves in one of the darkest periods of history, both morally and spiritually. We've become so enlightened now that we believe it's okay to murder unborn babies still in the womb. We've allowed violent crime and drug abuse and sexual perversion and broken homes and political corruption and international terrorism to be the order of the day. And yet in the midst of it all, the light of Jesus Christ shines ever more brightly. But you know, as I said earlier, the brightness of the light, it comes with two reactions, which we discussed. Some will back away from the light, and some will run towards the light. So the question is, what are the consequences for these two sets of people? And here, dear friends, the Bible is explicitly clear. Those who reject the light will experience darkness for eternity. And it's not as if God is not showing forth his mercy in this time. It's that the people reject and rebel and do not want to experience the light of Christ. They've made a choice to reject God and his way. And so God, being a just God, he gives them over to their rebellion. And we are told that those who reject Jesus will spend eternity in a place called hell. In fact, the Apostle Paul writes this in 2 Thessalonians 1 verse 9, that they will be punished with everlasting destruction and shut out from the presence of the Lord and from the majesty of his power. And you know, dear friends, this is a difficult teaching. It's a powerful teaching. And yet we know that those who reject Christ, it's taught in the Bible very clearly, will spend that eternity in hell. And we know that those who don't follow Jesus, they now know something of the presence of the Lord, but when they're in hell, they'll know his presence in a new and a profoundly different way. They'll know him in his wrath. Right now, those who reject Christ, reject God, they experience the common grace of this world, the way in which the world sustained and continues, and they experience the comforts of government and home and all those other things. And that is the presence of God to them, even though they reject him. And yet in hell, they'll experience God's presence in a very different way. They'll experience the wrath of God in a way in which he wholly, in his holiness, punishes those who have rebelled and broken the law of God. And you know, the Bible stresses the agony of the fires of hell, but it's nothing compared with the thought of being eternally in the presence of God's almighty wrath. That will be a desperate thing. And Paul says in 2 Thessalonians 1 and verse 9 that those who reject Christ will be shut out from the presence of the Lord and from the majesty of his power. They will not experience these attributes of God and their goodness anymore. It'll be the attribute of wrath. And you know, the Bible teaches that when we reject the light of Christ, we reject God's presence. That's a difficult concept to wrap our minds around. We are saying to God that we want nothing to do with him and his goodness. And if we make the decision to reject him now, we are making an eternal decision to reject him forever. And yet he will be present with us in hell, but he'll be there in his wrath. But you know, the good news of the Bible is there is a positive side for those who follow the light. They are promised that they will always have the light. And as certainly as there is an eternity of separation for those who don't want God, there is an eternity of communion for those who have surrendered to him. And you know, the unity that we now have with God, if we're Christians, is but a shadow of the personal relationship we will have with him in eternity. Jesus describes us as possessing the light of life, and that is the life that comes from God, the life that is experienced by following God. It is the life that is God. And if you are a Christian, dear friend, you are already experiencing the light of Christ. That is yours. But you're still living in a very dark world. We know that, don't we? We see that around us. And yet the day is coming when darkness will be no more for you, and all you will know is the pure light of being in the presence of God. Reminds me of a story. A woman named Rose Crawford had been blind for 50 years, and yet she received a surgery that restored her sight. And as that happened, she said, "I just can't believe it." And she just praised the doctor who lifted the bandages from her eyes after her recovery from this delicate eye surgery in Ontario. And she wept for joy when, for the first time in her life, a dazzling and beautiful world of form and color greeted her eyes that were now able to see. And yet, that's an amazing thing, but it's not the most amazing thing about the story. The amazing thing about the story is that 20 years of her blindness had been unnecessary. It turns out a surgery existed that could have corrected it. But she didn't know that surgical techniques had been developed and that an operation existed that could have restored her vision at the age of 30. And the doctor that did the surgery said this, quote, "She just figured there was nothing that could be done about her condition. Much of her life could have been different," end quote. You know, when I read that story and I heard about her case for the first time, some questions came to mind. Why did she continue to assume that her situation was hopeless? Had no one told her about the wonderful advances in eye surgery during her lifetime? And yet then I thought about the plight of those unreached by the gospel. How many will go on living in spiritual blindness because they have not seen the light of the Savior? How many will never see the true light that has come into the world? And how many have yet to have the bandages removed from their eyes? My friend, if you do not have a living relationship with Christ, the resurrected one, I ask you to repent, to change your life, to place your faith fully in the Lord Jesus Christ, to find a faithful local church where God's word is honored and preached faithfully, and be baptized for the remission of your sins, for the forgiveness of your sins, into the triune name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. There is time. If you can hear this, there is time. There is a time of mercy right now where God is extending you a second, a third, a fourth, a fifth, a 500th chance. But that time of mercy will not last forever. All of us are going to die, dear friends. And so maybe today is the day, as you hear this video, that you need to give your life to Christ. I invite you to do so, if in fact you have not already. Dear friends, thank you for joining me today for another lesson in the Mind of Christ seminar. My name is Matthew Dowling, lead teacher for Strengthened by Grace Ministries. And until next time, dear friend, may God bless you.